Hi, it's Howard Jackson back again, and just to continue with the theme that I've been working on for quite some time, and I wanted to share with you, this is the 40 years, past 40 years experience really of working with some outstanding leaders, and sharing those traits that they all have. And today I want to talk about strategy, in particular leaders and what they do to actually deliver on the strategies. And before I start, I just wanted to make this statement, really, that the mark of great leaders is that they look for great talent and get out of the way. I've talked a lot about engagement and taking on really top talent, surrounding yourself with great people, all the things that that great leaders do. So as leaders, we must maintain a healthy dissatisfaction with the status quo. We're constantly trying to push the boundaries, try to improve, constantly try to improve, learn and learn from our mistakes also, and take ownership of those mistakes and develop. So it's interesting that, and I wanted to share this with you, because there's so many, I see this so many times over the 40 years, I've seen this so many times that I just thought I'd go through. And there's 10 key issues here, 10 key points really. I'm gonna share the first five with you on this session. The next session I'll take you through from 6 to 10, but I think it's fair to probably say and make a statement to say most school leaders have fresh ideas, good intentions, a willingness to take action. So why is it so hard to turn strategy into reality? And as I say, I've sort of listed from my experience the top 10, and I'm going to share the first five with you. So here we go. First one, the goal isn't clear. This is all about why leaders don't get their strategic objectives achieved. What is it? Why do they fall short? And number one is the goal isn't clear. Fuzzy goals lead to fuzzy outcomes, basically, I'm saying. While it seems obvious, many schools just simply don't articulate the specific goal of a development strategy. So it's very woolly, very waffly. It might have all the DFE buzzwords in it, whatever, in some strategic goals. But has it got some, you know, is there something that you can hang your hat on? Has it got who's doing what, when it's going to happen, what the outcome's likely to be from it, and so on. And also with lots of opportunity costs. What if we're doing strategy A? What can't we do in strategy B? So that's the first one. The goal isn't clear. The second one, the goal isn't compelling. The why provides the impetus to achieve the what, really. If the goal is a nice to do rather than a must do, it's unlikely to happen. And so you've got to consider as a leader, what makes a goal a must do? And I've worked in many, many schools where the leaders in the school, they come up with lots of objectives all the time. And maybe it's the CEO, it's the principal, whatever. You know, I've got a great idea. This is the latest thinking. And the staff, the rest of the team know they're not likely to see it through, because within a week or two, they'll sort of probably get bored with it and go on to another initiative. So they ignore it, basically. Say, oh, yeah, whatever. Wait until he or she has been bored with that and we'll move on to another one. So it's no point in putting lots of time and effort into deliver it, because we know that it's just not compelling enough, the story, to grip people to get involved. Number three, too many goals. When everything is a priority, as you know, nothing is a priority. So many so-called strategic plans have too many goals, objectives, success drivers, strategies, initiatives, so on and so on. And worse, it's not clear how these various appendages are linked. Is it any surprise, therefore, that these plans sit on shelves and collect dust? So choose to do fewer things much better. And the analogy I always use, a football analogy, which is strange, but David Beckham, what an outstanding footballer he was. He had a right foot that was just sensational. He had a left foot, which was just to keep him upright and stop him falling over. And he had a head that he very rarely used. After, when he was playing for United, at the end of the day, he would stay behind and he would practice extra. And the question is, did he practice with his left foot to try and make it better, try and get it up to some reasonable level? Did he practice with his head, which he very rarely used, but would obviously come in handy at times in the course of a game? Or did he use his right foot, which was already possibly the best right foot in the game? Well, what he did is he practiced with his right foot, because he knew that the left foot could only get to average at best, and heading it may be the same. his right foot, which was outstanding. He continued to practice to try and make it even more outstanding. And I think sometimes in schools, what we tend to do, we dumb down the great outstanding stuff that we do because we've got to concentrate on bringing up to a standard some of the stuff we don't do very well. And I think that's a shame that that take place. And maybe the Ofsted is partly to clear to blame for that as well, and the sort of regime that we have. But who strives to be mediocre? You know, let's do fewer things and let's do them in an amazing way. That's what makes us a great school and a great leader. Number four, the plan that we put together is vague. So many plans are simply a brainstorm list of ideas and things to get done by unspecified people at indeterminate times. So, you know, a plan which specifies outlines, who will do what and when, and takes into account the sequencing and timing of tasks, activities and resources is much more likely to happen. So, but it's something that schools' leaders fall down on. The plan is just too vague. We need to be able to articulate it in a very specific way. Number four. Number five, people aren't engaged in the planning. I've spoken about this in previous sessions, and I think it's massive. And my view is really buy-in without engagement is virtually impossible. If you want people to be engaged, they need to have a voice in the planning process. That means either a voice at the front end of the process, focus groups, being one example, or a voice after the draft plan maybe is created. When people are involved in the process, encouraged to provide input, which you want them to do, they feel engaged. Doesn't mean that strategic decisions are done democratically all the time. That's sometimes unworkable. They're not, but it's about respect. Are they asked? Do they feel heard? Effective planning is done through people and not to people. So those are the first five issues that I've come across in my experience, and I want to share those with you, where leaders just end up failing in trying to deliver their objectives. I'm going to go through the next session, I'll go through the next one. So thanks for listening. I look forward to seeing you next time. Thank you.